apologise if I'm a bit comedy. I'm going to talk about British policy and unaccompanied refugee children. Am I on? Can we have a right?
Yes.
Our subject is British government's refugee policy in connection with the admission in of late 1938 of well over 9,000 unaccompanied refugee children, overwhelmingly Jewish, from Nazi-controlled Central Europe. They came on what became known as the Kindertransport. What led the British government to agree to this? And why were the children chosen? I will start with the context and priorities of British refugee policy. I'll then explore how the British government's priorities were expressed in its handling of the pressure for refuge. Next, I address aspects of the policy relating to unaccompanied refugee children, and I'll conclude with brief thoughts on beliefs and preoccupations concerning Jews that shape policies on refugees. So, British refugee policy, its context and priorities. As a bystander to the Nazi persecution of Jews, the government had choices about how to respond when, from early 1933, Jews started to arrive at ports seeking refuge from Nazi persecution in Germany. But the government's options were limited in a number of ways. Britain's inter-war immigration policy, following an international pattern of immigration restrictions, no longer let aliens enter for settlement. Depressed economic conditions meant severe restrictions on the entry of aliens for employment. Those seeking refuge now lacked any legal protection against exclusion, and were so in no better position than other immigrants, all of whom had to show that they would not be a charge on public funds. In these circumstances, what was the British policy response on refuge? Well, its general guiding principles remained remarkably constant. The details of policy might change, but self-interest always limited the scope for humanitarian considerations. Policy on the unaccompanied children was no exception to this rule. Rather, it illustrates and illuminates it. The defensive character of British refugee policy was apparent from the outset. It had three key priorities: maintaining the ban on primary immigration, restricting the entry of Jews, and avoiding being saddled with homeless, destitute refugees. Policymakers perceived Jewish refugees primarily as immigrants needing permanent homes. In the interwar years, the British, unlike the authorities in Palestine and the United States, did not admit refugee Jews for permanent residence, and did not see it as an option for the refugees to settle here, although the odd exception was made. But the stark reality was that to obtain even the temporary refuge that was all that was on offer, most Jews needed to show that their ultimate disposal elsewhere was assured, or at least likely. Suitability for such re-emigration meant, above all, youth. And emigration prospects were skewed towards the young. Additionally, despite being designated as birds of passage, the refugees also had to be considered suitable for stay in Britain in the long term, in case they should in the end fail to re-emigrate. Furthermore, in all cases, their financial support had to be assured. Thus, the problem of what to do with the Jews always took precedence over the question of what might be undertaken to save them. They were seen primarily as immigrants, posing a problem of disposal, and only secondarily as refugees, deserving of a safe haven. All the above self-interested criteria had to be satisfied before humanitarian considerations could come into play. It was only then, in the case of persons seen as both desirable and posing a low risk, that they would fail to emigrate, that policy would accommodate the admission of refugee Jews. The government was secretive about its refugee casework policies, thereby safeguarding its wide discretion in making decisions. As for its participation in international organisations and meetings purporting to explore ways to help refugees, this focused on furthering British foreign policy objectives, while at the same time clinging to sovereignty over immigration policy. So, how were the preoccupations just mentioned expressed in the handling of refugee questions? In 1933, Anglo-Jewish leaders took the initiative of offering the government an open-ended guarantee of financial support to underwrite admissions of refugee Jews from Germany. Over the next 5 years, the Home Office, which was responsible for immigration, admitted around 10,000 refugee Jews in reliance on this guarantee. One of them was my father. Then, the moment came when what had been the Jewish refugee problem became a refugee crisis. In March 1938, Germany's annexation of Austria, the Anschluss, triggered a ferocious campaign of Nazi persecution of Jews, leading huge numbers to try to flee. Anglo-Jewish leaders quickly warned the Home Office that while they would honour their guarantee for refugees already admitted, any future admissions would have to be cleared of them first. Bereft of its precious insurance policy in respect of new arrivals, the Home Office lost no time in stemming the flow of refugee Jews. It reintroduced a visa requirement for Germans and Austrians. Now, British passport control officers handling visa applications in Central Europe were issued with new criteria that explicitly excluded most Jews seeking refuge. Countless Jews desperately seeking escape now faced a daunting prospect: nearly closed doors to Britain and around the world. The post-Anschluss months were frustrating for advocates of refuge here. Yet there were chances to get to British Britain, especially for Jewish women willing to meet the insatiable demand for resident domestic servants. Ultimately, over 20,000 of them arrived. They included my Vietnamese mother and subsequently her mother, and were dispersed into British homes. It was only in November 1938, after the Kristallnacht outrages so horrified British public opinion, that the government, facing unprecedented pressure for action to save endangered Jews, agreed to facilitate large-scale admissions. A high-ranking deputation of Jewish leaders had approached the Prime Minister, Neville Chamberlain, seeking admission of young people, including those coming for education and training and eventual emigration, for whom they offered a guarantee of support. Also requesting the evacuation to Palestine of 1,500 children. Chamberlain got his cabinet colleagues to support an expansion of admissions on a humanitarian basis for several categories of refugee. Unaccompanied children were one such group. All such children whose maintenance could be guaranteed could be admitted. Ministers further agreed to streamline immigration procedures. This, though stated, was permissible because, while individual selection remained the norm, a less detailed scrutiny was permissible for those coming for temporary refuge. Workers and voluntary organisations could now select candidates for several categories of refugees. So turning to aspects of the policy relating to unaccompanied refugee children. The government's decision to expand admissions of children and other groups reflected humanitarian sympathies, but within strict limits. The changes just outlined were not part of any alteration of British policies or of overall policy. There was no exception from the requirement for financial support. Only temporary refuge was intended. Indeed, in the spring of 1939, the Movement for the Care of Children from Germany controversially introduced demands for new mandatory deposits of £50 per child, equivalent to £3,000 today, to cover the cost of the children's re-emigration, until in June, the Council for German Jewry agreed to accept this responsibility for future arrivals. The tension is obvious between notions that the children would re-emigrate and the desires of many prospective foster parents for a child that would become a permanent member of their family. Indeed, some of these families expressed a preference for orphans. The government made no effort to resolve these ambiguities. The children's admission, as we've already heard, was predicated on their separation from their beloved parents in circumstances where that separation was likely to be permanent. Their parents were rarely eligible for entry here in their own right. And without their parents, the children were acceptable here. Why? Partly because I suggest it was the Jewishness of Jewish refugees that was seen as particularly problematic and their main disability. A desirable, in quotes, Jewish immigrant was preferably one who did not stand out as Jewish. And children, especially those separated from their Jewish parents, their sorely missed Jewish parents, would be less visibly Jewish, dispersed into British families, attending British schools, speaking English. Children would fit in. Over time, they would be, as was very often said, anglicised, hastening their assimilation. If some were ultimately allowed to remain, they could contribute good white stock to the population at a time when the birth rate was low. Indeed, we see references to ideas that a proportion of the children, mainly girls, might be allowed to remain. So I'm going to finally offer my brief concluding thoughts on beliefs and preoccupations concerning Jews that shape policies on refugees. What part did attitudes towards Jews play in this way of thinking about refuge? British attitudes to Jews range from sympathy via ambivalence to antipathy. within British society, including government circles, we see evidence that anti-Semitism did play a part in limiting humanitarian sympathy for Jews. And policymakers treating the entry of Jews as needing careful control would cite fears that admitting too many refugee Jews would stimulate anti-Semitism. Yet, certain individuals who expressed anti-Semitic views still acted to support Jewish refugee immigration on humanitarian grounds. Chamberlain was one of these. And I will briefly mention the conclusion explored in my book that the critical factor in the British conviction that it was necessary to prevent significant Jewish immigration was not anti-Semitism. Rather, it was an assumption that Jews were a problematic element in the population and that it was therefore necessary to restrict their numbers. I suggest that this assumption was not based on attitudes to Jews particularly. Rather, it was a consequence of the prevalent concept of the British nation state as being both in essence and ideally an ethnically homogeneous entity. Nationalistic aspirations for ethnic homogeneity were widely expressed in interwar Europe. German Nazism was an extreme example. In Britain, beliefs that the nation should preserve its identity through preserving its notional ethnic homogeneity cast Jews and substantial Jewish immigration in a problematic light. One expression of such a belief, or one indication of such a belief, comes from the conclusions of a meeting in April 1943 of a cabinet committee on refugees. In connection with a discussion of which areas surviving Jews might return to after the war, the view was expressed that not all Jews should return to their countries of origin. It was pointed out, quote, that the Jewish element in the population of Poland was proportionally higher than was healthy. That proportion in pre-war Poland had been 10%. I suggest that preoccupations such as these underpinned ideas that no nation should be required to tolerate more than a certain proportion of Jews. I should say that something like 8,000 Jews' lives were, Jewish refugees' lives were saved by coming to Britain, and that in 1939 the population of this country was something over 47 million. So, these preoccupations, I suggest, help to explain why the underlying rationale of the British government's response to Jewish suffering was that the problem of what to do with the Jews took precedence over efforts to